All right, so hi, I'm Brian Kardell. I'm a developer advocate at Igalia, and this is the fifth in a sort of a joint series that we do on BlinkOns and also on our own thing as Igalia Chats. This is about the history of the web with people who helped build and form and shape the web early on. You can view the whole series on our Igalia Chat site. We've had a lot of different guests, and I think this one is really particularly interesting because I have my coworker and co-host of our Igalia Chats, Eric Meyer.
Hello. Thanks for having me, Brian. It's actually, it's what old farts like me are good for, is telling about how it was back in the day. You kids.
Anyway. We have to work in, get off my lawn at least one time. okay. So just some interesting things. I know a common theme in a lot of these is these are people who are around before the web, which is like a perspective that is rapidly disappearing, right? So somehow we got involved in some way. And when the web was not at all a given that it was going to be a thing. And, you know, we're sort of early adopters. Having access to a computer even was still pretty rare in a lot of cases. And having one with internet access and being able to, like, learning about the web in the first place was not a given. So I'm curious. I always like to ask this question, like, what put you in sort of the right place at the right time to learn about these things? And like, how did you get involved with the web?
Okay. So, first of all, I went to school in Cleveland, Ohio at Case Western Reserve University, which is not a military academy. I went there to study physics, and I graduated with a degree in history and minors in astronomy and English and a couple other things. And I immediately went to work for the university, figuring that if I worked there long enough, I could make back everything I'd given them in tuition. So I was, this was summer, fall 1993, and I was a hardware jockey. I was installing, I think there were 386 PCs to be online card catalog terminals. And the card catalog ran off a mainframe in those days. Like an actual mainframe. And there was a grant or something, I'm not sure. Somebody had gotten the money to buy a bunch of these desktop PCs that were just installed all over the libraries, like at least one on each floor, usually more than one on some floors. And then it would open a VT100 emulator, and then you could search the online card catalog. Because we were transitioning away from the paper card catalogs at that point. So I was doing that, which meant going out in the field, but it also meant sitting in the office and, you know, doing paperwork. But sometimes I didn't have a lot to do. And my former roommate, actually, and now coworker, and the guy in the office next to me, and still a friend, Jim Nauer, showed the rest of us in this little library information department this brand new thing called the web and this brand new program called Mosaic. And most of us, like, I think the rest of us were like, okay. And, but see, that was before embedded images when he showed it to us. And then when the embedded images came out, he was like, you really need to look at this. And like, showed web pages with images, and you clicked and went from one page to another. And that's when the light bulb went off in my head. So this was probably fall 1993. It was an early Mosaic beta. That's how I got involved in the web. I was immediately taken with it. I had some experience with hypertext in the past, having nothing to do with HTML or the web. So I was kind of pre-sold on the concept. I liked the idea of being able to, like, go from one point to another, from node to node, as it were. But seeing it, like, on the internet and being able to, like, here's the homepage of CERN in Europe, and here's, you know, a different university, and here's a library of whatever, that just immediately took me. I think at first I thought, like, my initial reaction was, this is really cool. I can't wait to see what they do with it. And then Jim said, and here's how you make documents, and had like a printed copy of the HTML2 specification, which was not very thick. I was like, wait, we could do these? That's awesome. So that's how I got involved.
Yeah, I think actually when before you came to Igalia, you and I had a chat, and it, like, we're very close to the same age. And you got involved just really a couple of years before me, but like, I actually learned a lot of things early in my career from you because you went to Netscape.
Yeah, I did. That's true.
And you got involved with the CSS working group.
It's actually the other way around with that. So,
but both things, right?
Both things did happen, yeah. But they happened in the reverse order. Yeah. So, one of the things that I started doing was I started making web pages for the university and quickly realized how simple it could be. Like, I thought most people could do this actually, because I want to make it clear to everybody, at the time we had HTML and we had HTML, right? There was no CSS yet. There was no JavaScript. None of that stuff. It was just markup. And what the browsers did is what the browsers did. So there was this, there wasn't even an emphasis on it has to look a certain way. It was just going to look however it looked. And you could do a little bit to tweak. I mean, this is before table markup. But I thought, wow, I could teach the librarians HTML. So I started doing HTML classes, and then I wrote some online HTML documentation, and that actually got like tutorials with little quizzes. And those got really widely linked. And so I was able to sort of leverage that into getting the university to send me to some conferences. All right. I mean, I got a paper accepted, a coworker and I, and so the university, the vice president of information technology was like, "You're going to present a paper? I will absolutely pay your airfare to send you to Paris." We're like, score. And that's where I ran into CSS. And so I started testing and documenting CSS, and that led to various things. And then eventually I got hired at Netscape in like 2001.
So you became before that an invited expert to CSS through your appearances at the conferences and your testing on CSS.
Yeah. So I eventually developed, I don't want to call it comprehensive, but it was a thorough test suite of CSS. It like just went through the specification, and each section was like, section 5.2, blah, blah, blah. And so I would have a test page for the stuff that was in section 5.2. If that was, margin, then it was a margin test. If it was background color, it was a background color test, whatever. And you could click from one to the next to just see like, what does this browser do? Because so in that Paris conference, I saw a presentation on CSS with Chris Wilson, now at Google, Hokan Lee, Bert Boss, the two co-authors of the CSS specification. I can't remember who the other panel member was, but they were just, it was like this new thing. So this is 1996. CSS 1 isn't out yet. It's like this new thing that we're doing called cascading style sheets, and it lets you do these things. It's really cool. And so, as soon as I got back, because back in those days, laptops weighed about as much as a desktop computer does now. So I did not travel with a laptop. I traveled with literal paper notebooks. And so when I got back to the office, back in America, I immediately started using CSS, and I immediately started loading it into browsers like Netscape, and it immediately didn't work. It didn't do what I thought it was going to do. So I started like, okay, am I wrong? Or is the browser wrong? Like, I can't tell. So I started to build these very simple test pages to, to do things like, when I did this combination of styles, this happened, right? So I'm going to test each of them individually and simply. It's like, okay, background color is supported. Great. And padding is supported. Okay. So it must be the combination of those two in Netscape 4 that causes this gap to appear between the borders and the background, which was a real Netscape bug. The background only filled out the content box. So if you had any padding, you could see the body background through that gap between, basically in the padding. They fixed that early. But again, right, like I'm just trying to figure out how does this stuff work. So I started to develop this set of pages, test pages, and eventually got it to the point that it covered all of CSS 1, which was, again, not a very thick specification. It was like 50 pages or something, if you printed it out. I don't remember exactly now. But so I took those And I contacted Chris Lilly, who was then chair of the CSS working group. And I said, hey, I put together this thing. Would the working group be interested in this? And he wrote back and said, would you mind if I shared this with browser makers and the working group? I was like, yeah, go for it. That became eventually the official CSS1 test suite. Because W3C at the time didn't have a tradition of testing and test suites. Specifications did not carry with them the expectation that there was any sort of like real world testing of whether or not things worked.
This is really unintuitive. I've talked about it a number of times in my own talks. I did a thing when it was technically, it depends when you measure from, but like the 30th anniversary of the web would have been like a couple of years ago, if you measure from Tim's original paper,
which I do. So,
and the interesting thing here is like, if you put together like a timeline, right. Mm-hmm. And then you look at when all the things happened, it's really clear that like from that, you can see things were really rough going at first. Like the W3C, like it didn't call itself a standards organization. Tim was specific about that in his book. He wrote a book. They made a recommendation, not a standard.
Right.
And there was no, you would think, I mean, today we have web platform tests. I think it was 2012, maybe. I mean, we're talking the W3C was formed in 1995. So to put a time window on the things that you're talking about, and 2012, I think we had 1% coverage in terms of what the web platform was in 2012, because that was still, still like a really new effort. So actually like the thing that you did to make tests was huge and groundbreaking. And like the interoperability of things was really bad. I think it might be worth like talking about some of that, because you went to Netscape and you ran, what was the Netscape Dev Edge? Is that what it's called?
Yeah. It's called Dev Edge. What is now Mozilla Developer Network was at one time called Dev Edge.
Yeah, it had some like obscure things like the fish cam.
The amazing Netscape fish cam.
Amazing Netscape fish cam. Which
dates back to like 1994. Yeah,
tell us about that really quick, just because nobody will know what that is.
So, well, maybe a few people watching will. If Chris Wilson is watching, hi Chris, he'll know. Somewhere in 1990, I think around 1994, I don't remember the exact date, not too long after MIT, somebody pointed a webcam at a coffee pot. The whole idea was you could be sitting in your office and you could pull this up on the web to see if the coffee pot was full or not. But the URL got around because there was no, like nobody was authenticating anything in those days because there were 16 people on the web, so it didn't really matter. So it was like this coffee cam.
Not like a heavily guarded trade secret whether the coffee pot is full either. So, yeah.
No, it was literally for the people in the office to know, like, oh, there's coffee. Somebody just made a pot of coffee. I'm going to go get some coffee. Right. So not too long after that, I believe, somebody in the JavaScript department of Netscape pointed a camera at the fish tank that they had. Like, have a big fish tank because it's California and corporate offices and proto VC culture. Of course they had a big fish tank, saltwater fish tank, no less. And, they pointed a camera at it, and then the amazing Netscape fish cam like circulated around the web, because this was in the days when the NCSA, the National Center for Supercomputing Applications, which is where Mosaic was developed. They had a weekly thing called the NCSA What's New page. And every week it would be a list of new sites on the web, and there'd be a dozen, maybe a dozen and a half per week that were new. And it was short enough there could be a link, and whoever compiled this would write like a sentence or two about why it was interesting. And it showed up on the What's New page as the amazing Netscape fish cam, and like the entire web, which at that point was maybe 167 of us, went and looked at the amazing Netscape fish cam. It's like, there's a fish swimming by, like, one frame per second, but you could see the fish swimming by. And they set up like here are some of the fish you might see and stuff like that. So DevEdge inherited that page, the amazing Netscape Fish Camp page, and I got to redesign it.
Yeah, and that, you know, you would talk about certain features, but a lot of the things they wrote about were like also the quirks and incompatibility issues, right? Like you wrote about, which is like interesting to try to talk about and convey. Like, so before this, we had a little organization where, you know, we talked about what we would want to talk about. And one of the things that we both went, oh yeah, that's like kids today, right? Like we had no dev tools. There were none. Like there were no dev tools.
No,
nothing. You could use an alert. That's pretty much what you could use.
Your dev tools were alert, document.write, and view source.
Yeah. And a lot of people watching this are like, well, what about console.log, right? But no, there was not console.log. There was no console.
Because there was no console. Exactly.
There was no console to log to. And then long after, there were some kind of dev tools. Like I think, what was the, Venkman was the JavaScript tool.
Yeah, JavaScript debugger, as we would understand debuggers today, you know, like setting breakpoints and stuff like that. So Venkman, yes, was added to Mozilla. Oh, geez, I don't remember now. But it was kind of one of those very early things where it's like you could actually set breakpoints and step through your JavaScript code. That was, I mean, mind-bogglingly revolutionary at the time.
A lot of these things, I think, also started as like extensions. They weren't even like mainstream in the thing.
Yeah. Joe Hewitt's Firebug became basically a web inspector.
Yeah. And I think what's really interesting about this is that even once we had things like that, well, first of all, they were ragged. Like it was not, you had these longer release cycles. Yeah. You had a really long period where Microsoft left the game and like it just sort of stalled. And yeah. So even long after we got something simple like console.log, if you can believe it, it was not compatible in the most rudimentary of ways. Microsoft, I believe it was, I know it was 6, but I believe it lasted until maybe even 10. It was a long time anyway. Where the console object, you would, you know, you're a developer, so you open your computer and you open your dev tools because like that's where you live and breathe, right? Like once you have them, right. You're like, I just keep them open all the time while I'm developing the site. And then you click ship, and you know, some people argue maybe you shouldn't be sending console.log stuff. In fact, Microsoft did argue that. You shouldn't be sending that to production. But right. I think there are totally valid and valuable reasons to have logging in production sometimes.
Yeah.
And the thing is, when you close the dev tools in Internet Explorer, the console object would go away. And so it would throw, and then anything after that, you know, in that context wouldn't run. And so very frequently, like you could push something and it worked great as long as you have dev tools open. But if you didn't, nothing would work.
Right. Then your JavaScript broke.
Yeah. I'm curious, like from the outside, I've watched standards, you know, for a long time. And I don't know how many people watching this, like, watch standards at this level. But we did have this, like, period where, like, the W3C seemed very, very, like, promising. I was all in, like, anything that they would have worked on or picked up, I would have assumed it was as if it was written in on stone tablets, you know. It was just a matter of time before we would get it interoperably on all the browsers. But it turned out to not be that way, and that's not unusual. And even today, you know, things follow a bumpy path. Like we get an idea, maybe even a browser gets interested, maybe they even develop it. And you know, along the way we find a better idea or, like something else comes along. And I'm just curious, like, is there any standard thing that you saw come like be a proposal, get serious consideration and be sort of interested and excited about that ultimately just didn't happen or hasn't happened yet or like.
Yeah, there were quite a few. The serious consideration though, that's an interesting question. I mean, all the things that come to mind were seriously considered by at least the people who were working on them, whether or not browser makers or the relevant working groups seriously consider them, I guess is a little more fuzzy, and I don't want to comment on that. But there was a simple vector format before there was SVG, and the syntaxes are actually not very similar. SVF was not based in XML because I think it might predate XML.
Interesting.
I mean, that promise was fulfilled by SVG eventually. Mm-hmm. But it's 95 or 96. I don't remember clearly. I remember sitting in a birds of a feather meeting about people interested in vector formats, and SVF was heavily discussed. There was a P3P, which I'm still sad didn't go anywhere. That P3P stands for Platform for Privacy Preferences. And the idea was that you could, as a user in your browser, set what levels of privacy you were comfortable with at a fairly fine grained level. And then servers would be required under the specifications to honor those. So if, you know, I don't remember what the exact levers were, but let's say there was a lever for no third-party cookies. Like you could set that at the browser preference level. And you could set like certain, I think the idea was that you could kind of do them on sliders, right? So like the bottom would be never track me with cookies at all. And then we sort of got some preferences like that, but there were many levers you could fiddle with. And it was designed as a specification where you could, you know, it didn't prescribe only these levers and never anymore. It was more like, here are the core levers, but then you can like more could be developed. Right. I really liked that one. I was sorry that it never went anywhere. There are various reasons we could speculate as to why. And, you know, I think the most sort of crucial things did eventually get set, right? So in browsers now, when it comes to cookies, you can say, you know, set all cookies, I don't care, or only set first-party cookies, or never set any cookies, right?
A lot of per-site things, too, in browsers. Yeah.
A lot of per-site things. And that was, anyway. There were a bunch of HTML elements, particularly in HTML 3.0, not 3.2, that I really wish had happened. FN for footnotes.
This is a great segue, I think, into, you know, I was going to ask about, we were talking about like the things that you've seen come that you were like, I wish it had made it. Specifically in terms of like, let's say HTML, we can do CSS too if we have time, but I'm curious about HTML and the sort of anecdote that plugs very closely into the thing that you're mentioning before about headings. I just would like to say that if you wonder about the H1, H2, H3, H4, those are legacy that were inherited by HTML that had been around for a really long time since like the 60s. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And the very first real email that Tim sent to WW Talk, which was mailing list where people were to discuss, they was set up to discuss.
Right.
The web, Tim sent, this is the current state of HTML in my one browser that has implemented it.
Right.
And this H1 to H6 stuff is kind of, we should probably get rid of it. Just make a section with a heading tag. That would be great.
Yep. Just H.
That is my biggest, golly, I wish we had got that. Like,
yeah.
So what about you? Can you tell me some? Do you like the person one?
I like person. I like note and footnote. There was a credit element. So you could like, here are the credits for this page, or here's the, in a figure or a block quote, you could give credit. There were several others. They're not instantly coming to mind, but there were some interesting. I think there was an AU tag to implement to represent the author.
It's just to denote where Australia is.
Yeah, exactly. This is the Australian part of the page. You know, AU, crikey.
Yeah, it's really fascinating is that you can imagine so many semantic elements. And it probably has a lot to do with why we wound up going down a very deep semantic rabbit hole for a little while there. But if you look at like the amount of time spent debating a lot of those and like the implementation of them is almost like it's nothing. And you could just, you could use the element in your page today. And if everybody used it, then we would have to write it down as long as you agree.
Right.
Like that's how dictionaries work.
Yeah, pretty much.
Most dictionaries anyway. Yeah. Yeah, I think it's really interesting. Address is another interesting element where we wrote it down and said it means specifically this, like it must mean this. And nobody intuits that that's what it should mean. Like it was not supposed to mean like a street address, right?
Right.
But everybody used it as a street address. And so we had to go back and say, I guess it's the street address is fine. That's along the lines of what you're saying. Like a lot of standards today, like they have to write down like what people actually did ultimately.
Yeah.
And so we can prescribe a way, but if people don't use it that way and they use it some other way, we have to come back and write down the truth.
Right. And this is why JavaScript polyfills and preprocessors, even though I don't hardly ever use either of them myself.
Yeah.
I have nothing against them. It's just for what I do, not things that I use for the most part, but they're super useful for what are people doing? Let's write that down. You know, there's stuff in the CSS color level. Is it 4 or 5? Whatever the latest working draft CSS color specification is, that has stuff like, you know, current color darkened 40%, which is stuff you can do with SAS mix-ins, you know, where you can have like color shifting functions. And that's, again, a thing where the working group saw what people were doing in the field and now is trying to write it down in a way that like fits with CSS syntax and also does not clash with directly with the syntax that's already in use in preprocessors. That's a whole rabbit hole we don't really have time to get into, but they try not to step on each other's toes for the most part. Right. So yeah, that's why that I really like both of those things existing in the world, preprocessors and JavaScript polyfills. Cause with JavaScript, you know, you can trial proposed specification. We worked on the temporal API or still working on it. JavaScript API for time and dates here at Igalia. And there's a JavaScript polyfill or, you know, JavaScript library that basically does its best to implement the temporal API before browsers had committed a line of code to supporting this API, right? To sort of trial it out and figure out, okay, like what have we not thought about? Super great. That's moving forward and temporal is starting to land in browsers, at least parts of it, and working that forward. It's really cool.
It really is nice on multiple fronts. Like one is the standards can take a really long time, and the more sort of talk there is and everything, the more like multiple ways it can go. And everyday developers, like they have things to do, right? They can't afford to track a feature for 7 years, but they can, once you give them a standard, tell you like, did it meet your needs or like, was it just terribly painful to use or, and the benefit of those things is that it could really tighten the feedback loop, I think, where like it is a good incentive if you have a need for somebody to say, well, there's not a standard yet, but there is like a polyfill. And like, try it. And like, if it meets your needs, let us know. And if it doesn't meet your needs, also let us know.
Yeah. Like, how did it not work out for you? How did it break? How did it limit you?
Exactly. That is a big change, I think. I think other big changes is like lots of the teams, like the players have moved, and the sort of philosophy, how we think of the companies behind things, has really changed. Like a lot of the people from Microsoft are at Google, and people at Mozilla are at Google or Apple. People from Google are at Apple.
It is interesting, because for a while there was that period where you sort of people became associated with organizations. So, mm-hmm. Chris Wilson was at Microsoft for a long time. Right. Yeah. And he's a Microsoft guy. Well, he's been at Google for like a decade, 15 years. I don't even remember. He's been there forever.
Yeah.
And I have to remind myself, oh yeah, Chris is not at Microsoft. He's at Google.
Definitely.
And that's not new, but yeah, to watch people move around from one organization to the other. I mean, I suppose you could sort of say the same as me. I was at Netscape for a couple of years, 20 years ago, and now I'm at Igalia, which is another implementer, basically a browser manufacturer, and massive contributor to, Chromium and WebKit and stuff like that. So, and Gecko for that matter. I did take like 20 years doing other stuff on my own. But, and getting the perspective of people who have hopped from place to place is always really interesting, right? It's like, okay, I've worked at every major browser manufacturer, and, here's what I think about this process. And, have to at least listen to that, in my opinion, because someone absolutely. Who's been on the inside of these various processes, if they say, look, here is the way to not go about doing X, mm-hmm. right? Because implementing such and so. It's like you give that weight. Doesn't necessarily mean you blindly follow what they're saying, but you really have to give that weight, because they've seen how the sausage is made in this case.
Yeah.
And speak from the experience of, look, I've seen it from inside these teams, and I can tell you right now, if you approach trying to get something done in this way, you're just gonna bounce off a brick wall, basically. And if you try it this other way, you at least have a chance.
So we're rapidly running out of time. Oh. But there is one more thing that I would love to give you the opportunity to talk about, which came up. I had asked you to think about what was one of your favorite projects that maybe even people don't associate you with or know about. You mentioned,
So I have a couple of, I have bookends, and I picked the term advisedly. One of the first projects that I did after sort of making the university website was two of the professors of our history department, one of whom I'd taken classes from while I was getting my degree. I think both of them, now that I think about it. Anyway, they had written the Encyclopedia of Cleveland History. So encyclopedias of urban history are just kind of a thing, right? There's an Encyclopedia of Chicago History, New York History, San Francisco History, Cleveland History. So they had written the Encyclopedia of Cleveland History and the Dictionary of Cleveland Biography, right? Which was a separate volume that Victor Schreckengost, who's a very influential mid-20th century designer, was a Cleveland native, lived to be 102, and actually lived right near where I live. So things like that. Jesse Owens, Cleveland native, so he's in the Dictionary of Cleveland Biography, etc. So they wanted to, they had seen where, I think it was the Encyclopedia of Chicago History, had put some of their articles on the web. And they said, we want to put everything on the web. So we did. We basically did it. It wasn't XML, because this was, again, sort of before XML, but we basically made up our own markup language, stored it in a database, and then had output filters that output that to HTML. The Encyclopedia of Cleveland History is still online. I believe it's at ech.cwru.edu. Obviously, I haven't had a hand in it in a couple decades now. But like I led that project and it was the first example of the entire text of a encyclopedia of urban history being made available online for free.
That's awesome.
Yeah. And like, you know, I have a degree in history. Clearly I have love for the subject. So that was really fun. And then just recently, like literally, this year, a colleague and I, Chris Griffith, we're both kind of space nerds and also students of nuclear history. My degree in history, I actually studied sort of from World War II onward, sort of the Cold War and nuclear arms and their effects on international relations. So there's in the field of the study of nuclear weapons, there's a U.S. government publication called The Effects of Nuclear Weapons. It went through three editions. The last edition was in 1977. It's the third edition. And it's been available, like you can get PDF scans of it, but that's it. And Chris and I like each literally own physical copies of it. That's how like everybody who has studied the field has a copy, basically. We wanted to put it online. Again, full text, as accessible as possible, like HTML, raw text, like, you know, none of this PDF scan stuff, because PDFs are not very accessible. And even if they've had the text OCR'd, sometimes the OCR software does not do a good job. So we did that, and that published, we put it online in August of 2022, so about a month ago, nice. As we record this. I'm kind of proud of that. I mean, it's a U.S. government publication. It's been in the public domain for years. I mean, because it's a U.S. government publication, it's in the public domain. It's all unclassified stuff. Like, my understanding is that there's a classified version of this book. It's classified, so we don't get to see it, but this is the unclassified version. So I appreciated it for the history, for my personal interest, and also for taking a text and putting it online as accessibly as possible using sort of the most basic technology we could get away with. The only JavaScript we're using is actually MathJax, because there are a lot of mathematical equations in the chapters of the book. And rather than try to like render them all in SVG by hand, which is what we would have had to do, we were like, we're just going to use MathJax. We'll write it as LaTeX. Boom. Which works great. I mean, hopefully MathML will start to become a first-party markup language again, in part due to work that Igalia is doing to get it into Chromium. If we get to that point, I'm absolutely going to go back and the things that can be rendered as native MathML, I'm just going to translate. I'm going to like turn them over into MathML, and the things that for whatever reason can't, if there are any, then I'll leave them as MathJax. Anyway, so those are two things that I'm really proud of, because they're taking information and putting it online. That's sort of what drew me to the web in the first place. This idea that you can take information and put it online so that anyone can access it, anyone can learn from it. But beyond that, XFN, the XHTML Friends Network, that Tontek Celik and Matt Mullenweg and I created back in like 2003, which was a way of adding semantics to the web without having to invent new elements or entire new languages. It was a way of saying, okay, well, if you class or you use these other attributes in certain ways, in these patterns, then you can add semantics. And XHTML Friends Network, though some people might not remember that, but people had blogs. And on those blogs, there would be what was called a blog roll. A list of links to other blogs that the whoever's blog you were on were blogs that they liked. And so the XHTML Friends Network was a way for you to be able to mark each of those links to say, you know, href equals meyerweb.com, rel equals colleague met, right. Which is a way of saying, this is a colleague of mine. And also, I have physically met them in person. Right. So there was the possibility of creating networks of trust. Mm-hmm. Right. So if you've met, like if you had a link to my blog on your blog roll and someone's met you and maybe there was a way to expose that you have met me in person, mm-hmm. right? Then I am less anonymous in a way.
Yeah.
Right? There's more reason to trust that I am a person who exists, you know, in a certain sense. That was fun. It it was the foundation of microformats, which in a lot of ways was a big influence on schema.org.
And kind of social graphs in a way.
Yeah, that was what XHTML Friends Network was for. Microformats then took that design the design principles that we use in XFN and applied them to things like marking up calendar events. So that you could say, this is the event title, and this is the date, and this is the time, and start time and the end time, and the blah, blah, blah. I'm blanking on one of the other. There were several microformats. And again, this probably sounds familiar to people who are saying, oh, so you ripped off schema.org. Well, no, the arrow goes the other way. I'm not saying that the schema.org people ripped off microformats, because microformats were absolutely a, here is a thing anyone can use and be influenced by. And it seems like they were influenced by. There was one other project. Yeah, it's time. So I have not, like, maybe three people in the industry know that I did this. But back in 2005, there was a team at Apple responsible for the website apple.com who felt like they should get away from their table and spacer GIF markup of their site and convert it to standards, to like semantic HTML and CSS. And through a set of circumstances, I ended up doing that project. I worked with my contact at Apple, produced a style guide, produced a markup guide, converted a bunch of top-level pages from table and spacer to, you know, divs and CSS, or, you know, I made this markup as semantic as I could.
But it was internal, right? The look and feel didn't change.
Right. It was all about the code. There was no change to the design of the site. And that was, in fact, one of the project constraints. And it was one of the challenges, right? Because if somebody did a thing that was difficult at the time to do in CSS, I had to figure out a way to make it happen. Which again, like, we didn't have grid, we didn't have flexbox, we, like, all we had was floats and positioning, basically. So I had to figure it out from there. So I did that. And that's why, actually, a thing that that's been noticed over the years, anywhere there was a bit of legalese.
It's in Wikipedia, like this bit.
Okay. No. So, so if there was, like, the legal notice would say class, I set a class of Sosumi, which is it's like a System 7, I think, or Mac OS 7 or 8 sound, like a system sound called Sosumi, and I made like this plinking sound. There's a whole backstory that I'm not going to go into, but it was...
But you should look it up, because it's great. It's great, yeah.
Yeah, and it's called Sosumi, because Sosumi is what it was, but it was written to look like it was like a Japanese term or something. So it's S-O-S-U-M-I. So as we were doing this, and I got down to the footer of the site where there was like copyright 2005 Apple Incorporated, all rights reserved, blah, 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 whatever the legalese was at the time. I was like, okay, I want to represent this with a class because it's small and it's gray and it's, anyway, I'm going to represent it with a class. So I said to my contact at Apple, is you okay with it if I call this class equals Sosumi? Because I think that would be a really fun little Easter egg in the markup. He was like, yeah, totally, go for it. So I did. And so that's you can still find it in various little places. It's mostly faded away. So that's why I guess I feel comfortable talking about it now.
Yeah, it's noted. I mean, it's noted. People have pointed it out. You can search for it. Not that it was you, but that, you know, this Sosumi class, a lot of people finding the Easter egg in there and getting a giggle out of it and sharing it.
Yeah. So yeah, it's been long enough. And when you asked the question and I thought about it, I was like, you know, should I talk about it? I've kept it quiet now for 17 years, but it's time. I think that's long enough. I could have waited for 20, but whatever. 17 is fine. So that was a really fun project. It was because it was a real challenge, but
Great story, though.
It's fun working with Apple, even if on the down low.
Yeah.
Because I'm mostly an Apple guy. Have been since my university days when I worked in a Macintosh computer lab.
Yeah.
But yeah, it was a lot of fun, and it was great working with people inside Apple, getting to visit the campus at one point. And it, between that and working with people like, not working with as in like being employed by, but interacting with people like Chris Wilson when he was at Microsoft and now at Google, Tontek when he was at Microsoft, Dave Hyatt when he was at Apple, and before that when he was at Netscape, getting a feel for like what the people working on the inside are like.
Yeah.
I think has been a real benefit, because it's easy to say Google, Microsoft, Apple, these huge titans, these monoliths of whatever, they're made up of people, and the people inside often, even if they can't say so, have very strong opinions about how these titans products should behave and what they should prioritize. And those may sometimes be in conflict with what the organization as a whole might want. But they do their best to make it happen anyway. And it's been a real privilege actually to be able to see that.
This is a great final story. Thanks for breaking the news here.
Sure. Well, thanks for giving me the opportunity to finally come clean.
Yeah. So we'll wrap it up, and I guess I'll see you at work on Monday.
All right. Thanks, Brian. Bye. Talk to you later.